So the next speaker is Dr. Asraf Faisal Alsahafi. Dr. Asraf is the Director of Quality Management Department, Assistant Professor of Pediatric Gastroenterology, King Saud bin Abdulaziz University for Health Services, and Consultant of Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hematology, and Liver Transplant, King Abdulaziz Medical City, National Guard, Health Affairs, Jeddah. And the lecture will be evidence-based treatment of gastroesophageal reflux in preterm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you again for the scientific committee for this invitation and contribution to the scientific program. Actually, the reflux is one of the most difficult topic in older children rather than preterm. So a discussion in the evidence and the treatment of reflux in preterm like a fight without riot. So something that happened, and then everyone has his own approach, but there is no strong evidence to support either. Anyway, so from the title, it is something that we need to look for evidence during this exercise, and I have to do the exercise and go to the PubMed, use the search engine, looking for certain keywords, including preterm infant, gastroesophageal reflux, gastroesophageal reflux disease, and we make some filter for English language. Then after that, I got 175 paper. After reviewing the abstract, it took a few days, and then we reached the 14 RCT. And the RCT categorized according to, as you see here, is four category. There's some RCT done looking for comparison, different position of the preterm in terms of the controlling reflux. Medication, there's some RCT for ranitidine, proton pump inhibitor like esomeprazole, omeprazole, pantoprazole, and prokinetic agent, mainly the erythromycin, and the metoclopramide done with the ranitidine study. And then there is another RCT doing the type of milk formula and milk additives, I mean thickener, like cooked starch. And then there is some study looking for different age, neonate and preterm, in the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamics of the pantoprazole mainly. So there is usually diversity in the quality is a good culture and you get a good result, but diversity in the study, something that really you cannot lump the evidence and come up with a strong recommendation for the people how to practice how to manage the reflux. Then, so what the conclusion from this review before we go for the category, each category there is a table there. So there is no standard definition of reflux. So in the study that we reviewed, some people, they go with the vomiting, regurgitation as a definition for reflux, and then they treat for that, and then see the response. Some, they look for attribute symptoms, not something related to, maybe it's related to reflux, like bradycardia, like apnea. And then after that, they do the intervention and see if there's any reduction. Another group, another study, they look for pH probe, and we know that the reflux in the preterm, there is no a clear number, so we compare that to the adult data and children data, but usually they have weak acid. So then when the impedance comes to the place, there is non-acidic reflux detected. The pH did not detect that, so there is acidic and non-acidic reflux. Another people, they look for maybe it's more for aspiration rather than as a complication of reflux, like doing a tracheal aspirate for a pepsin as one of the indicator of the aspiration. So this is the definition that in the literature we can't go, and each study done in a certain context of patient, ventilated patient, for example, there's some patients with bronchopulmonary dysplasia, some patients they are fine, some they are grower and feeder, and the case. One more point that about erythromycin. Erythromycin used for different indication. One of the indications that looking for reflux. The other indication for erythromycin that used in the NICU practice to promote the feed, trying to push the feed forward for early discharge and to reach a full feed. And as a secondary outcome, they're looking for reflux improvement. So looking to this type of study, is there no surprise that most of this study is small sample size? Because number one to me, that to calculate a sample size, you have to have a good definition for the disease. Then to diagnose the problem, to know the prevalence and the incidence, and based on that, you need to decrease this number by this difference, 10%, 20%, you calculate the sample size. But if there is no way to go and to know who's having reflux other than maybe pH or impedance, which is a more invasive technique to diagnose, which is high risk for those babies, very fragile. So this is one of the explanation why, because we found in some study based on our experience, we've had this number, but I doubt that number from the start. How they reach that number, there is no clear definition for reflux. Then, reviewing all these data, you can generate some trend of the evidence, where this evidence is going forward, but you cannot make the assertive or the confirmation that there is strong evidence, there is no strong evidence. So it's not conclusive at the end. And one of the interesting things that there's a two Cochrane review just published recently, over the last 2 years. And that Cochrane, they went step after step after step, and the conclusion of that Cochrane, there is no good study to analyze in this Cochrane. And there's nothing, and that the scenario. So I went to the same exercise. It wasn't a recent exercise to go with and looking for all the study. First, the positioning. We have Professor Hani Ali here. He published a paper in 2015 looking for certain position, lateral position for ventilated baby and the definition of the reflux or the aspiration here is by confirmation of pepsin by reagent, specific reagent. And the study concluded there's a better left lateral is one of the things that shows significant reduction in the pepsin. Then there's another study about position, include 10 patients, and the same, say, the opposite right lateral position. But there's another study called left lateral. So going to the methodology, the one with that right lateral is not the same population of the patients that is studied in each RCT. And it's difficult to come up with the conclusion, or at least if I need to do meta-analysis, they have now 3 RCA, but based on the criteria, I can't lump it together to generate the evidence. Medication. So medication, same thing that the definition to use pH probe to diagnose reflux, bradycardia the study, and days to full feed. From the starting the medication, till the full feed, how many days we need, and then they compare together. Anyway, same thing, maybe there is better sample size, but still is not enough to make a conclusion. And most of the study, the first paper here, there is no difference between the two. The second paper, there's a case mix, you can't generate a good evidence from that. And the other one did not have any impact. And the other two is something that I will come to the next slide to show. So doing erythromycin or placebo for two arms, looking for days to full feed, there's no difference. And the B value is 0.74, and from 39.4 up to 43 days. But anyway, if we look since 1997 till 2012, there is a change in the behavior of physician. I don't know how, because maybe of awareness of the side effect of metoclopramide, maybe number one. Number two, maybe there's some regulatory things that controlling the prescription of this medication. Or number three, that is there is a belief in the clinician this medication is not working. So the trend, there is a peak between 2000 to 2007 that about the use of metoclopramide. and then decline. But if you look for erythromycin, it is something that the percentage of infants that receive erythromycin is almost stable. There's some fluctuation in the percentage, but almost stable. But there is a big metoclopramide, maybe after the other, maybe control. There is many reasons can explain why there's a significant drop. I think it's multifactorial. So this is also one thing that will limit the use of the things that you will see in the RCA. If you have a patient that you are doing certain intervention in the era of the peak of the metoclopramide, and now there's the prokinetic is not used anymore, and this depends on 8 million discharge studied, multi-center, and this, and they study 8 million discharge, how many of them exposed to metoclopramide, and they calculate the percentage over the years. So it's a good number to give a clue. So pantoprazole is the case mix I mentioned, and it's different aim for it's not for treatment of flux rather than looking for safety and pharmacokinetics of the medication, and the conclusion is safe. But I'm sure that in the future they will come and they will mention pantoprazole maybe it's not safe for preterm, because now we see some complication for the adult, hip fracture and bone health and the other, and other some side effect that we see. So now we'll come to type of the milk formula. Extensively hydrolyzed protein formula 2013, but correctly he did that, and there is reduce of acidic reflux and no difference in, so a reflux is the same, but it changed from acidic to non-acidic because pH detection of that reflux becomes less, but the impedance detect the same thing. So that means that they might correct or they neutralize the acid there, but the volume is coming frequently as before treatment, after treatment. So the cooked starch, because also one of the things that not every thickener that we can use in preterm because of the possible side effect later on, because we have different product for thickening of the milk, and one that it's for preterm is very specific option, and there is no difference with that. So now as a conclusion from this, all this 14 RCT that is reviewed, different population, there's different feeding modality, different feeding protocols that also affecting as a one of the factors that affecting decision about the efficacy of your intervention, specific intervention of medication or other. There's special circumstances like there's bronchopulmonary dysplasia and others, and we know there's some preterm with maybe CNS, they have some oromotor skills is not okay, or is not well developed, that it needs time to develop. Maturation of the GI tract, and we know that, as I did in the first talk, that there's some receptors and there's some signals that need to develop over time to control the GI motility, to control the secretion of the hormone and the bile acid and others. So now, if we decide to start treatment for reflux, how to monitor? Shall we keep the pH probe all the time there in the throat or the esophagus and measure that, or bring the patient every now and then to the endoscopy suite or in the unit that we do the pH to decide? So starting the treatment maybe is the, there is no evidence, but easy things to do, but how to monitor that? And one of the difficulties, shall we go by weight, by symptoms, by others, or just go with the same way that we diagnose pH to monitor the by pH metry or by impedance? So this is one of the difficult questions that it's not easy to answer, at least for me. And then the other difficult question, if I start the treatment now and there is a response for that patient, when to stop? We don't know, because I get a referral to my clinic coming as an NICU graduate, and they are on omeprazole or metoclopramide or domperidone or anything. And there's very few patients that I see once every 4 or 5 months, 6 months. And then the question that the family, they feel that the baby is doing well on this medication, and I don't believe in that medication, I need to stop it. Then if something happens, who will be blamed? I don't know. But the things that, is that a right decision to start this medication? Then for how long we should continue? Shall we put a criteria for us if there is no vomiting? If there's a weight gain, if he's developing very well, then we can stop or we don't stop that. So also there is some difficulty about the timing of stopping this medication. The other thing, shall we go and wean the medication or not? I mean mainly the antacid. Why I'm saying that? Because this is the paper that published in 2009 in gastroenterology. It's a very interesting paper that they use the PPI or proton pump inhibitor for a healthy individual. They give them for a few weeks and then they stop that medication. There's a rebound hypersecretion. Why that happened? Because we know the hormonal drive of the acid secretion is the gastrin. And if we block that, the gastrin will go up and up and up. Then when we stop the medication, we stop the medication maybe at high level of gastrin, and that will cause a surge of the acid secretion. And this is very common to see in the clinic that you continue on medication for 8 weeks, for example, treatment with H. pylori, and then you stop the medication, the patient will come two days later, feeling more acid, and then you resume the patient. This is the way that at least in some scenario, change the practice to wean the medication by 25% every 3, 4, 5 days. Is this applicable to preterm baby? The answer, I don't know. But this is the evidence that we get from the adult side. We practice that in children, older children. But for those, I do believe neonatology is different medicine from pediatric medicine. Something different with different pathophysiology, different physiology, different motility. Everything is different. So we have to have a solid evidence before making any recommendation. So the weaning is one of the things that we have to think about it when we decide to start the medication. Then let us go and do the exercise of grading the evidence behind this type of study. It's very difficult for me to go for that because clinical diagnosis of gastroesophageal reflux by vomiting or by regurgitation or bradycardia or apnea or changing position or any other behavioral things is not reliable, and that was proven by a study that they compared the pH with some clinical symptoms that we thought or we think this is due to reflux, and the result wasn't convincing. There's evidence that these symptoms really mimic reflux, due to reflux, sorry. Body position, left lateral, at least we have two RCT that they are supporting these things, and there's some people they recommend that to do it and lift out and prone for a certain period after feed for 30 minutes, 1 hour, and then put the patient on supine because of the risk of prone position. So anyway, so positioning, maybe it helped based on the available evidence. And then medication, I do believe strongly that there's no evidence to start the medication. And maybe there's some colleague here or from the gastroenterology, they believe on that based on their practice, but I cannot say that I have evidence to support starting medication. The only thing that even thickening, there's some result here and there, I call swinging result is positive and negative or there's no effect. But anyway, that also the safety issue for preterm, it's a very concerning when you start treatment like this for preterm baby. Anyway, I think the conclusion here, if you have a patient or preterm, just reposition and stay calm. Things will be fine, inshallah. And unless you have a clear indication for this medication, like having sign of esophagitis, which is not common, or you have a sign of for example, gastric empty is delayed, you can use some prokinetic, but otherwise, I do believe there is no strong evidence to start any treatment. The only thing is supportive things, and they are growing kids or growing babies, things will be better. Today is not tomorrow, and today is not like yesterday. Thank you so much.